how we'll be back and we'll make things better. I almost expected him to say, make Israel great again, because it was, you know, a very grandiose speech attacking Bennett, saying that he was able to absorb everything, that he was absorbing terror attacks, that he was absorbing Iran agreement progressing with the United States, basically, you know, saying that he wasn't as tough as Netanyahu had been. I have to say, I don't think, you know, his punches landed, you know, very well. He also said that he was absorbing a lot of corona deaths. The things that he was attacking and he was criticizing Bennett for were policies that were, you know, very, very, very similar to the ones that that Netanyahu took. So he also, you know, showed great restraint when Israel was attacking. So you know, despite the force and the screams of his Likud party in the Knesset, it doesn't seem like Netanyahu's speech really packed a punch.
Ben Dror, do you agree? Not agree?
Generally speaking, I do agree. I just would say that, yes, Naftali Bennett is not a great speaker. Yes, we know it. I mean, it's not his point. The point is that when we are speaking about Netanyahu, we need a fact checker for every sentence. For example, he spoke about Iran. Come on, who led us to the current situation with Iraq? He spoke about retaliating to terror. Come on, what are you talking about? Who gave the money to the Hamas with suitcases? Who? What are you talking about? They were launching rockets again and again, and you did nothing. It does not happen now. Now, this government is retaliating immediately, on the moment, on the spot. What did he do? Almost nothing. I mean, he let the situation deteriorate. And we can go on. Every sentence. And well, so my question is, excuse me? What are you talking about?
Michael, the former Likud lawmaker, well, what do you make of the criticism here of your journalist colleagues?
Look, after a government of that is in power 113 days, every success you can attribute to the previous government, and if you are the opposition, and every failure, as my colleagues tried to do, you can attribute to Netanyahu. Just when Yemini spoke, I tried to see, to remind myself, who were the defense ministers when in the previous government, and I remember it was Bennett, and then one Benny Gantz. So. I believe it plays. I believe Netanyahu, what is amazing, went into his new job as head of opposition with no hesitation, as if the 12 years he was running the country were not existing. Now he is in the shoes of Menachem Begin, that was 8 terms head of opposition. And he does his work well, and I believe his punches land. And I believe, as an opposition, he's doing his role to criticize the government.
Well, if the punches landed or not, this is just the first round of a 15-round boxing match that's going to play out in the next half or a year or so in parliament. There are going to be so many more chances.
As Mao Zedong said, the journey of 1,000 miles starts with one step. This is the first round. Well, let us win the first round.
Well, that is the big question, really. I mean, is this government going to be able to withstand all of the attempts of the opposition to land those blows? And they will have opportunities to challenge this coalition because of the makeup of the coalition, which is so diverse.
It looks like the winter session of the Knesset started today, but that's an illusion. When this government will really start, if it starts, is going to be on November 14th, when the budget comes up for a vote. Really, this the success or failure will not rely on who gives the stronger speech and you know, who looks like a tougher leader, Netanyahu or Bennett. But if this budget gets through, if there is the passage of a budget in the Israeli government for the first time in 3 years, this government is going to be on much, much solid ground, and you're going to see things transform on that day.
Certainly, the passing of the budget will be very critical. I want to ask another question here, an important question, and we also saw it in one of the speeches that the Prime Minister, Naftali Bennett, was giving when he was talking about the delegation of the Paralympic athletes And one of the Likud lawmakers shouted out, what about the Meretz party delegation that visited Mahmoud Abbas? That is a subject that certainly there is no agreement within this coalition. What do you make of that visit of the left-wing Meretz party to Ramallah to visit Mahmoud Abbas? Well, and can that sort of maybe show cracks that could form in this coalition because of the different positions regarding the Palestinian issue?
If we did not know that this composition of this government is a kind of miracle, now we know it. I mean, there are so many parts contradicting each other. So I'm not surprised. And I'll tell you something. I don't think that Meretz had to go to meet Abu Mazen. It should have been Naftali Bennett himself. And I'm saying it not because I think that Abu Mazen is going to make peace with Israel, not at all. According to his speech 10 days ago in the UN General Assembly, he was terrible, speaking again about right of return, which the meaning is destruction of Israel and so on and so on. But it was always, but always, Israeli leaders who said yes to peace, who said yes to negotiation, always. Even Menachem Begin, just when he came to the prime minister office, what did he do? Peace. What did what did Netanyahu do? Just the same. Negotiation, even with Arafat. We know his views. We know the views of Begin. We know the views of Netanyahu. But Naftali Bennett is declaring publicly, I'm not going to meet Abu Mazen. This is the big shame. Not the fact that Meretz party members are going to meet Abu Mazen. It is Israel that should always say yes, because Israel is prospering by saying yes. It was the Arabs who always said no, and we saw the result. I don't want to change places with the Arabs.
I want to ask you, Michael Kleiner, is this a button maybe that the Likud party, Netanyahu, will try to push again and again regarding the Palestinians, the Meretz party, Mansour Abbas of the other Abbas, Mansour Abbas, the one in the coalition of the
Mahmoud
Abbas. Right, there's Mansour Abbas from the Islamic party who is in the coalition, and Mahmoud Abbas, the head of the Palestinian Authority. That's certainly a very weak point, link in the chain here.
Look, first of all, I'm happy that Yemini gave me an opportunity to defend Naftali Bennett. I believe Naftali Bennett did the right thing when he decided not to go and see the gentleman, leave alone that he was a Holocaust denier or is a Holocaust denier. His doctorate was to deny Holocaust. But the one who is giving money to terrorists and insists on giving money to terrorists, even if he pays a fine with with Israeli money he has to get. But he's also the one that in these days is going to The Hague and giving complaints against Israeli soldiers. So why go and see him? I believe it's a... And about Meretz, look, this is the agreement of this government. Naftali Bennett will not mention the Palestinians in the UN, and Meretz will go to see Mansour Abbas. And Naftali Bennett, what I do complain, that he gave the permission to Gantz to go and meet Abbas and speak not only about the technicalities they were supposed to speak, but also about the process.
I want to tell you a secret. I want to tell you just a secret.
Okay. Our other guest here. We're doing a rotation here, and she's waiting to get in.
For a change, we don't have an election coming up, but a lot of this discussion is political. Naftali Bennett is not Ariel Sharon, and he's not Menachem Begin, and he's not even Benjamin Netanyahu. He does not have a political base. He's a right-wing representative of a small party, so he can't afford to take the risks, to take the chances that these leaders took in meeting with the with Abbas.
And now I'm the left-wing.
There you go. I'm saying practical is practical.
You're sitting in the middle.
We see this.
I never knew that it's me, but it's okay.
We see this government, making nice and working together, but at the same time they're trying to keep their base happy, which means that Meretz has to show that it's trying to make peace. So they meet with Abbas, and then Bennett has to show his people that he's, and has to show the Israeli right to try to win them over, that he's opposing it. So a lot of this is a lot of posturing and dancing with knowledge that there really is going to be no substantial progress with such a diverse, crazy coalition leading the Israeli government.
Let me respond in 2 points. One, it was also Netanyahu that during all this time, yes, he met again and again, when he was prime minister with the Palestinian leaders. He did, because he knew not that he's going to achieve peace. He did not achieve peace, as we all know. But even Netanyahu in 1914, it's not a secret, he was willing to give up more than 90% of the territories in order to achieve peace. I'm speaking about the time of John Kerry and Barack Obama. It did not work out because, as usual, it was all rejected by the Palestinian leadership, mainly, of course, by Mahmoud Abbas, Abu Mazen himself. Second, yes, you are right. He doesn't have any base, but he is a prime minister of Israel. He is my prime minister. I did not vote for him, but he is prime minister. And I'm expecting every leader of mine to give his hand for peace. And I'm expecting every leader, even if I know the difficulties, I'm saying, yes, I know Abu Mazen is not willing to make a real peace with Israel. Abu Mazen is not willing to make any kind of compromise that will enable peace. I know it. But yet I'm expecting every Israeli leader to say, I'm willing to meet in order to try. But he's not doing even that. And because of that, but the point is that Abu Mazen, I'm not expecting anything. I do expect from my prime minister, and he's not doing it.
I want to ask, we talked a lot about Mahmoud Abbas. We have to talk about the other Abbas, Mansour Abbas from the Islamic Ram Party. And in general, the Israeli Arabs, the Arab citizens of Israel, make up almost 25%, 20, let's say 20% of the population, 20 more, 20%, 25% of the non-Jewish
21,
population.
21, yeah.
Right, different estimates, but a substantial amount. And there is finally a party in the ruling coalition that represents the Arab population. We've never seen that before, but it's also going to cause a lot of problems for this government. We already saw it with the citizenship law. We saw it in other legislation that they tried to pass previously, the nation state law. How is this coalition going to survive with the Islamic Ram Party inside?
Mansour Abbas took a very big decision, saying that he will leave the political questions of the Palestinians to Mahmoud Abbas, and he will deal with the population of the Arab, with the necessities, the problems of the Arab population.